Welcome to the Innovation and Technology Management Seminar Series hosted by the Engineering Management Program in the Pratt School of Engineering at Duke University. My name is Jeff Glass and I'm the Faculty Director for the Engineering Management Program. The purpose of our seminar series is to introduce engineers and scientists to various business and management concepts that they will find useful throughout their careers. Speakers represent a diverse array of industries from finance and information technology to materials processing and biotechnology. If you'd like to learn more about the Engineering Management Program at Duke, including these podcasts and any associated audiovisual materials that are sometimes available, please visit our website at memp.duke.edu. Thanks for your interest in our series, and please do not hesitate to contact us with suggestions or questions.
Good afternoon, everybody. Welcome to the session on this Friday, October 23rd, 2015. The only one you'll ever live. I don't know if that sounds familiar to anybody. In fact, I think it's the only one I will ever live. I want to be comfortable here. I'm going to take the tie off. I've been wearing this since this morning. I hope I don't knock down my, whoops. There you go. All right, so just a few years ago, like Dr. Murray said, I'm struggling with this thing. Can't do it. That was not part of the presentation. Okay, there you go. So just a few years ago, I was on the other side of this room. I was studying towards my MEng degree. Probably if you walk around campus, you'll be able to recognize me on a few occasions. Sometimes I did stand out among the crowd. I am the guy with the orange shirt in Cameron. Some other times I did fit much better though. That's still me. I was a Carolina game. Of course, we lost that game, but I was worth the whole time. So let's see. A few things that I enjoy doing just so you guys can know a little bit better what I do. Again, my name is Matteo Caporrella. Like anybody else, I am very good at giving away useless pieces of advice, like the first, put the lime in the coconut and then you mix it all up. I don't know if you guys catch the reference. If you don't, please take a note to Google Harry Nilsson, the song Coconut. Everything will become clear at some point. I do enjoy trance music. I don't know how many of you are familiar with what that is. I'm gonna spend a little time just because I can. It's a general electronic music. It's characterized by a tempo that lies between 125 to 140 beats per minute. There's a lot of melodic phrases that repeat throughout the tracks, and then there's tension that gets built over the song, and then it culminates with a beat drop. I don't know how many of you guys know. Just a couple of weeks ago, I was in Chattahoochee Hills, about 30 minutes away from Atlanta, at this five-day camping, three-day music festival called Tomorrow World. And it was a fantastic lineup, 9 stages. Last stage on Sunday was closed for whoever made it because we got rain on. But the last stage was closed by Armin van Buuren. He's a trance DJ. And I have a little video of the music. So just to give you a perspective, I was there to get with 150,000 more people. This is main stage. It's about the length of a football field, and about 50,000 people were dancing in front of it. Let's see if I can play it. I don't know how loud it's going to be, but you will notice the tension building up in the song and then dropping towards the end. Is anybody familiar with this? Okay. Just making sure. That's what it's about. Can't see much, though. Can't see much. Dance for whoever knows what that is. I do like more traditional things too. I'm a sporty person, I guess, like most of the people here. I do enjoy rowing. That's me, rowing with the colors of the Austin Rowing Club. For those who are not familiar with the U.S. geography, Austin is the capital of the state of Texas. Texas is the big state, the southernmost state that borders with Mexico. Great place to visit if you have the chance. One more thing I like doing, like I think everybody else in this room with no exception, is traveling. That's me walking in a village in Thailand, I believe. And so they sometimes ask me, what do you like about traveling? Or sometimes I do ask that question when I'm interviewing people or prospective Duke students. That's one of the things I do. And what I like to say is it gives me the chance to see and experience new ways of looking at things that can help me come up with solutions to my problems that I wouldn't have thought if I didn't see somebody else doing. And also sometimes it's useful to keep me grounded, understand what is that really counts in life, understand how, you know, important it is to appreciate and value what we have and who we are. There are people that are in much less fortunate conditions than we are. But let's go back to me. Let's see. That's my personal slogan. Fortuna audacious juvat. That's Latin for fortune favors the bold. I guess everybody here was bold enough to live your life and get today here sitting in, you know, this beautiful auditorium and one of the top-notch schools in the country. As I said earlier, I'm not going to hurt anybody's feelings if I say that, at least here. And what else? Yes, that's pretty much it. Oh, I'm a sales engineer for Reddwerks. How many of you have heard what Reddwerks or who Reddwerks is? Okay, beautiful. At least one person. So Reddwerks is an enterprise software company, right? That's an extract from a career pamphlet we delivered one day at career fair we visited. Enterprise software is any purpose designed software that's coded, I guess, or developed to satisfy the needs of an organization rather than individuals. So there are different systems that fall under the umbrella of enterprise software. An example are customer relationship management systems, or CRMs. Those are systems that companies use to automate, manage, and run marketing and sales activities or technical support or anything that's related to customer-facing activities. There are systems like enterprise resource planning or ERPs. Those are used by companies to collect and manage and analyze data coming from different departments. So it could be production, planning, operations, or sales. And then all those BI or business intelligence tools that companies just use to come up with these beautiful charts, they show how well they're doing or how bad, I guess, sometimes, fall under the category of enterprise software. But now that's kind of a generic definition. It's a busy expression. What does Reddwerks do? We do warehouse execution software. Not the prettiest enterprise software, I'll admit. Warehouse execution software is used to run distribution operations. Distribution is all that has to do with delivering product to somebody. When you place an order online on BestBuy.com or Amazon.com, I don't know if anybody still buys anything off of Best Buy, but that order goes into a system that then, actually a few different systems, and eventually gets down to the software that has to tell somebody, hey, John, go and pick this espresso machine and put it in this box of this size, apply this shipping label that has your name, and then put that in a truck to deliver to your house. That's what warehouse execution software is. Now, it might sound boring, or you might, you know, have hard times appreciating how valuable these systems are. Probably next slide is going to help you a little bit. These systems are particularly important when they can help prevent $100,000 worth accidents. This is a video that was recorded in a Russian liquor distribution center. course, it's in Russia. They drink a lot of liquor. There is a forklift driver, that little machine, the yellow machine on the top left corner, who hits the gas in reverse and plows into one of the racks. And I think it's pretty funny. Oops. Oh, I need to push it there. Hold on. So those are racks of liquor bottles and boxes, right? There's no audio, unfortunately. Be epic. There you go. There you go. Now wait for the box to settle. Look at that. See? That's epic, right? So that's kind of, you know, if they had maybe a Reddwerks warehouse enterprise off, that wouldn't happen. So to my knowledge, the damage was about $200,000. The people that were involved there, this looks like a little guy climbing there. We're harmless. We don't know if they kept their job for obvious reasons. Let's see. Let's talk about sales engineering though a little bit. How do we sell enterprise software? That's the first part of sales engineering name, right? I guess a good way to look at the problem is, well, I can use this, right? Mm-hmm. Why buy enterprise software, right? If you can understand why people buy things, then we can strategize and develop plans to sell them what we want to sell them. But you may find interesting to find out that the reasons why people buy things, including corporations and companies, are pretty much the same. In fact, we can talk about why would anybody buy anything. Probably have heard these a few times. I just have a few examples to go over with you guys. We buy things for basic needs, right? We're hungry, we need food to survive. We go and buy a cheeseburger at McDonald's. Corporations buy systems when they need them to perform basic functions that keep them alive. Marketing, finance, HR, sales, or production planning. Those are all functions that a company needs to run to survive. So companies tend to buy systems for basic needs. Convenience. Convenience is when you buy something that requires little effort or is, you know, not hard to acquire. Think about the time you ran out of gas and you just went into the closest station. Why did you pick that one? It was close enough and it wasn't too much trouble, right? Companies buy enterprise systems when it's for them convenient to do so. For instance, enterprise software is very customer specific, right? Sometimes it requires customizations that are specific to the customer requirements. And just so often happens that two customers have the same issue. So you can sell both the same product, right? But you paid for the development cost the first time, maybe you can afford to give them a discount the second time. That's where companies buy things for convenience. Replacement. How many of you guys still wear their third grade shoes? I'm not going to sit here and raise my hands. Nobody, right? Things just sometimes get old or not adequate anymore to support the requirements that companies have. Say a new regulation came out that requires a pharmaceutical company to track this type of pills that they had never tracked before. Well, then they need to implement all the systems and hardware that they need to start tracking the pill, right? So a company has to replace something that's old, not adequate anymore. Next point, scarcity. We buy things when we think they are going to become less available or just it's going to be harder to acquire or procure them. Think about that time that you run out of toilet paper a little bit too late. Who would have liked to buy something because they knew that that was running out? I would raise my hand in this case. Companies buy systems to resupply or to replace the one resource that's becoming less and less available nowadays, which is labor. Particularly in distribution, we're talking about unskilled labor. you know, people that go around and pick things into boxes, doesn't require a degree. And so they acquire systems that allow them to use less and less people. So the more efficient you do a process, the fewer people you need, the better off you are in fighting the labor availability issue. Next one, lower price. Just buy things because they're cheaper. We were looking for a TV 2 years ago. We walk into a Target store that had this giant screen that's half the cost. Sure, why not, right? We buy the TV. And so do companies just when they can find something that they needed years ago, but the technology went ahead and allowed them to allow the vendors to reduce the cost of these systems, the company will start looking for those. Great value. We buy things when we think that the value we're getting out of them is higher than the price we're paying. Think about that time that you went to a grocery store and you saw buy two, get three Hershey bars. Sounds like a good deal. You're getting more than you're actually paying for. I'll get the bars, even if I don't need them. In the corporate, or if I'm not hungry. In the corporate world, that happens mainly in three situations. When a company is after a return on investment, when a company is after return on investment, and you can guess the third, when a company wants return on investment, right? Next one, brand. When we are unfamiliar with a certain product category, we tend to go with a brand we know. So a couple of months ago, I was back home in Italy to visit my boyhood little girl, and he asked me to go buy diapers. Now, sure enough, I don't have kids, so I wouldn't know which diapers are better than the others, so I just go to the groceries and I ask, which one should I get? And so the clerk started asking me questions about the little baby girl that I had no clue about, and I said, can you just give me something that's well-known enough? And she said, go get Pampers. And about Pampers, my brother was happy with that choice. Right? I was totally unfamiliar with it, but I went with something that I knew the name of. Companies do that all the time. So in the enterprise system world, there is this leading consulting IT company called Gartner, and they produce marketing reports, and they show trends of how things are going. And every now and then, they come up with this new thing that they discovered. And just at the beginning of this year, they actually discovered warehouse execution software. So everybody thought, let's look into it. And now everybody wants to buy one because Gartner or somebody told them that that was a good thing to buy. Next one, innovation. We all buy new iPhones every time they come out. We don't. Most of us do. Even if our iPhone 4 just works fine because it's brand new. We want to have the latest and greatest anytime. So do companies. When something comes out that is new and everybody else is adopting, such as a new technology to scan barcodes, I'll give you that, a company will go out in the market and try to procure those new systems just because it's new. 1 minute remaining. Compulsory. We just buy things when somebody has power over us, tells us to. In the corporate world, that happens oftentimes when a new CEO comes up in charge and he mandates that this particular business unit needs to be refreshed or renovated or upgraded or whatever. And then, sure enough, whoever is reporting to the CEO, which happens to be everybody in the company, will buy that system. Peer pressure. Sometimes we just buy things because everybody else is doing it, and we want to feel part of the class, I guess. We buy something. So peer pressure is the main reason why teenagers smoke. Peer pressure is the reason why everybody does what Apple does. Right, Steve, Bill, all of those guys. They do what Apple did. Fear. Sometimes we do things or we buy things because we believe that something or somebody is going to harm us or cause pain. So I'm not going to show you pictures of my backyard bomb shelter, but in the corporate world, that happens when something is likely to be failing soon. So a company decides to upgrade a server because if the current one goes down, then we lose everything. And I believe that's the last one. There you go. So I was going to ask you guys, what do you think is the main reason that corporations buy things for? I spoiled my game. So that is great value. Again, return investment is the only reason why companies buy these kind of systems or why they spend money at all in the first place. I spent $100 million, how many million of dollars am I going to get and how long? That's really companies want to know. I'm going to buy this system or adopt this practice or spend this much money on this new product. How much money is it going to make me and how long is it going to take? And we can make money if we increase sales or if we reduce costs, at least in the corporate world. So what is it I do then? Talking about sales and how people buy things and how corporations buy systems. Well, if we tie back up to that main reason why companies buy things, that's where sales engineering comes in. We tell customers how much money they're going to make and how long if they buy this product at this price. In other words, we help them understand the solutions that that we sell them. Of course, that's not the only goal. I think I did this morning. I also work for somebody that pays me, so I need to maximize sales for them. That's what sales engineers do. Sales engineers are engineers that know how to sell systems and salespeople that know how systems are engineered. It's kind of an interesting or hybrid situation that connects the technical and the business world. Let's see, now that's what I do, but you know, what is that I really do on a daily basis? Quite a few things. I'm just going to go show you a few. If you have any questions, just let me know. It might not be as clear just because they're very familiar with me. First, I do on-site audits. So again, the main goal of a sales engineer is to understand how much money the company can make with my product. So I need to go on-site and understand how they're doing things currently so that when I study how my product would help them, I know what they're doing. So that's kind of more a consulting-like engagement. We go on site and we observe what they're doing. We document processes and procedures and try to come out with ways to help them save money by either increasing sales or reducing costs. I do presentations, no big deal. We present about our company, our product, about other customers, about ourselves all the time. We do demo or demonstrations. We show people how to use our product. So our product, for instance, runs on devices that are worn by people in the distribution centers. So we walk them through each individual step and show them how the application we are selling them works. Data analysis, again, that ties up to the on-site audits. We need to understand what the customer is doing, come up with metrics that are representative of their business. Sometimes they just dump bunch of data on us that makes no sense, and my job is trying to make a sense out of it. So that's probably the most engineering of the engineering-related of the tasks that I have to do. Solution design, again, we just define the requirements of the solution, trying to make sure that it helps the customer somehow. Project management. We do run little projects with the consulting engagements on-site audits. Usually those are performed by teams of people, of engineers. And my job is to coordinate their time on-site with the customer and making sure that everybody is doing what matters for the project. Implementation planning, that goes back to the more enterprise software related thing. These systems affect companies in a lot of ways, a lot of departments, a lot of functions. And implementing a system that's basically going to change radically what a company is doing today requires planning. And that's what I help doing too, understanding how we can run up or bring up a system given the current operations in order to minimize the disruptions. Legal contracts. We do sell things, and those things cost millions of dollars. We need to make sure that, you know, everything is right from a legal standpoint. That's done differently in different companies. In mine, because we are a smaller firm, I tend to having to do legal contracts that then we submit to the legal departments for review and final approval. Technical support. Of course, we are the face that sold the product to somebody. If the stuff hits the fan and that thing is not working, they call me first, right? Then I had to triage the issue and relay that to the appropriate personnel in my company and hope that they fix it. Marketing fluff. I'm in sales, so I know what customers want, the way they ask it. So I help the marketing department coming up with ways to message our product, how to sell it. And trade shows. I do go to trade shows. I don't know if any of you guys has ever attended one. Just go there and you prop your little booth and prospective customers or people that are interested in your product just come by and ask you, hey, what do you exactly do? I do this and that. So that's what we do at trade shows. Recruiting. Again, I am heavily involved with a lot of functions in my company just because it's a small firm. So, you know, we get to branch out to different functions. I do recruiting. I look at resumes. I interview people. Hopefully they didn't have their phones up in the interviews. Just kidding. What else? Entertainment. Now, that's probably something, I don't know if salespeople shared that too much, but you probably know from movies that vendors take the customers out on golf courts or restaurants or basketball games. I don't play golf, but that's part of the sales job, so I thought about sharing it. I do take them out for dinner, though. So if you come out to Austin, I'll show you a few things. Duke seminars. Yeah, that's the first time I do it. Maybe I'll do it again. I don't know. That's another thing we do. Let's see. But this is the main thing we do. We sell. We sell all the time. We sell ourselves. We sell our product. We sell our company. We sell our team. It's constantly selling. You heard probably this a lot of times. I remember any time you're interacting with anybody for any reason, you are selling something. So that's what sales engineers have to have different than just an engineer. We know that we're selling and we have to put some work into selling well, I guess. Let's see what I have next. I forgot now. Okay. It's a white slide, so I don't know what's going to come up. Okay, the big change, right. So the presentation theme was the big change ahead, right? No big deal. What is the big change that characterizes my story? So that's who I was by trade. I went to school to become an aerospace engineer. I grew up with the idea or desire to put my hands on those giant metallic tubes or pipes that surf the skies, airplanes. I focused my entire education and, you know, sort of professional experience in school towards aerospace engineering. And, you know, I think it's a pretty cool field. I did it for a reason. I'm just going to share a few fun facts about the engines that are flying that 787. That's a Dreamliner. That's what I used to work on, aircraft engines. So just those big turbines that spin around. I think somebody's familiar with that. What is? Yeah, okay, I missed it. Okay, so fun fact number one. Each of those engines can provide a thrust of about 150,000 pound force. That's equivalent to 1,500 average cars. I think it's pretty dope. They each consume about 1.25 or 1.25 tons of air a second. That's about the volume over a racquetball court. And at takeoff, the force on each blade that you see spinning around inside the engine is equivalent to 100 tons. That's a freight train hanging from each blade inside the engine. So that old stuff is cool, and that's what I did for a long time. But what happened was, this technology is related to defense, at least in the United States, I guess anywhere else. And in order to work with that technology, you have to get a security clearance. Now, in order to get security clearance, you have to be a citizen. Now, I know that that's kind of a politically incorrect thing to talk about, but I am not a US citizen. So after I graduated from Duke, I had, you know, everything was happy when I was at Duke and I was still into that field. I'm like super pumped up. I'm going to get a job in that field. I'm going to be successful in what I like doing. I've been doing this for my entire life. I sure enough want to keep doing this. But then I graduated, and actually it started happening a few months before I graduated. I was, kind of stressed out. I really was struggling finding a job, and the reason is, again, you know, no company would, or I guess willingly, or too willingly, sponsor a non-US citizen for this kind of jobs. Sponsoring somebody for a green card and, you know, a security clearance costs money, and there's a lot of good American talent out there, so companies don't really feel the need for sponsoring a foreigner, right? So I started looking around and got very frustrated for months. And at some point, I just decided that I was smart enough to get into something else. Now, the most adjacent thing to do for me was to get into the business side of things or into a role that had the word engineering in it, but it was more business related. So at Duke, I took a measuring class and the business fundamentals for engineers class. I don't know how many of you have taken that one. And I had realized at the point that those softer activities, like, you know, working with people and understanding what the needs of different organizations and teams are, was something I really enjoyed. So I applied for different positions, project managers, operation manager, and I got a couple of phone calls back, which I never... It never happened before when I was applying for other jobs. So I'm like, sure, I'll give it a shot. So I go to different companies and I start interviewing. I go to my current company and I'm sitting in this room with a CEO who's interviewing me for this project manager role. And the interview consists of about an hour of the guy talking to me. I was just standing there smiling and nodding. And then the guy says, so what is it you're looking into? What is doing for into job? And I said, well, I just like working with people and taking these classes at Duke, and I found this much more interesting than just the technical aspect. And he was, okay, so we need a sales engineer. How about that? Because I didn't know what that is. So the guy says, well, we'll write down an offer that has a description of your job, and then you'll look it up and see if you like it. It was a pretty good offer, obviously. I had a few other offers, project managers or operations manager. One was in the U.S., one was in Europe. Didn't have much intention to go back to Europe. So I took the job, right? So super excited. I start on a Monday. They send me out to California to learn the product because I had no clue of what the company sold, or what they did, or who they were. It's a small company. Nobody knows about us, right? So we fly out. We were supposed to spend 3 days on site, and I had clothes changes for 3 days. And what they didn't tell me and the other coworker that came with me is that the situation we're walking into was a total mess. The product they had bought from us was working according to specifications, but those specifications were not what the customer wanted. So basically nothing was working the way it was supposed to do. And we were in the middle of the fire dealing with the customer and other two vendors that were providing satellite systems to ours and trying to help these guys in understanding that the product was working the way it was supposed to, that it wasn't our issue, and showing them how the product actually works. So they were asking me questions, how do you do this, how do you do that, why did you guys do this? And really nobody understood that that was my first day on the job. I had no clue whatsoever. So I kept doing what I was good at, nodding and smiling, and I said, I'll take your question, you know, to my team and see who can answer them. So I ended up spending, from 3 days that we're playing, 5 weeks. Didn't go back to Austin. I had just moved to Austin, and that didn't feel like home for me yet. And I was just washing my clothes every day and hoping that, you know, nothing major would happen to them. And after 5 weeks, I go back and I said, I actually kind of like what was going on right there. Right? I like to be in the fire. I like to be challenged that much. So I spent another year in learning the job. Now, you may think that that was good time. It wasn't at all. It was actually hell of a mess. For about a year, I was struggling with understanding what I was supposed to do. I was the new guy, right? I had no experience whatsoever in that business. And I came from Duke University. Some people just have something against people coming from some places. And so I was facing a lot of, opposition, I guess. The current CEO of the company was one of the people that I was supposed to work with. And he confessed to me, I think it was last year, I've been at the company for 3 years, confessed to me that for the first 6 months that I was at the company, it was trying hard every single day to get me fired. Now, that is not a pleasant feeling or a pleasant mind to work with. But after the year, let me see what slide I have next. Okay, I don't know what it is. It's a blank slide again. So after 1 year, I just decided to stick with the company. I like what I was doing. The leadership changed in the company. Was lucky with that. The new environment got much better. And that's where I was able to thrive for the following 2 years, and I'm still enjoying my time. I'm really curious to find out what the next slide is. Beautiful. Okay, so that's where I am right now. I told you pretty much what I do. I told you what sales engineering is about. I told you why companies and people buy things. It was a big change for me going from aerospace engineering to a totally different field, doing something I had never done before, and by the way, in a language that was not my first language. And it was kind of rewarding, but where am I going next? And take a guess.
Music festival.
So why now?
So music festival, something music.
Well, that I'm going to actually this weekend. something week in Houston, for reference. The answer is I don't know. I don't really care. I don't think that matters. Because I didn't know what I was doing when, you know, I graduated. And, of course, if somebody can Google it, that would make me a huge favor. But, again, the idea is stay open to the opportunities that present themselves to you. Don't just focus on what you've been doing for your entire life. Sometimes things just don't work. If something is going all right, it's not worth spending any extra effort or money in it. Don't. It's fine to change, to be open to new opportunities. And if you focus on just what you know, the problem is a lot that's going on around you. So I'm closing with a quote in the next line. This one I remember because it's the last one. There's this guy that said that the measure of intelligence is the ability to change, right? And the guy was Albert Einstein. Now, I'm not Einstein, but I do like that quote, not just because it says I'm intelligent, I'm not. It's just because, how did it happen? I did? Well, so the point is, let me put it back on. I love the animation, that's why I want to show it again. Okay, so the point is, again, just don't be afraid of changing. If things are not working out, venture into new, at least try new things, and try to leverage, I think I was saying this earlier today, what you have. I didn't go for jobs that were totally out of my league. I was looking for something that was still engineering related, but it had the business flavor that I had found out at Duke was something that I liked doing. So just with that, I would like to leave some time for the Q&A session. I'm very happy to be here again, and I hope you guys enjoy the presentation, despite the little inconveniences that happened.